Tomorrow, of course, translates into today, and this is how it stands with these guys at the top. Kawasaki's Leblanc, Legree, Foray, Parks, Fritz and Silva second for Yacht, Watanabe, Jacobson and Kudlin in third place. The green names, of course, will be the ones that start the race. David Checker, Nico Canepa and newcomer Luca Mahias are in fourth place for GMT. Oliveira, Pryor and Luciana next up, and then the Cert Suzuki squad. And the rest, I'm afraid, are kind of also runs. But having said that, Greg Black, Gregory Fastray and Alex Kudlin, the younger of the Kudlin brothers, actually finished in second place at Le Mans on the Team April Motors events machine. So you could never quite tell what might happen. Notice that Julien Dacosta, Sebastian Jambert and Freddy Foray are down in 14th place for the official Honda Endurance Racing Team that's run, of course, by from Neil Tuxworth's workshops in Louth, in Lincolnshire, in the United Kingdom. So, gentlemen, getting back to what I asked you previously, who's pre-race favourite? Terence?
Pre-race favourite. You can't discount Cert Suzuki because they're always in the hunt, especially towards the end of the race, remember, because they're so well organised. I think it's going to be SRC Kawasaki. They've got the power, they've got the really up for it, you know, at this point in time. This is what I really miss about racing, actually. I mean, I've retired for quite a long time now, but I really miss this sort of stuff. You can never get this in ordinary everyday life, and you can see the guys are ready to pounce across onto their bikes. You've got to be really careful as you accelerate away. These bikes have got 220 horsepower, remember. Open the throttle too much, you go in and they're off.
So they head across to the bikes now. There's 30 motorcycles on the line. SRC Kawasaki, brilliant start. A terrible start for Brock Parks. The Yamaha hasn't fired up. And the Yacht team, number 7, have got to get off last. And the long plunge down into turn 1. They veer around the right-hander at turn 1, flick right into turn 2, and then we'll all concertina into the hairpin 40-mile-hour right-hander at turn 3. And then it's a sharp uphill. You swing left over a brine crest. And that's a terrific start for SRC Kawasaki. That's exactly what they wanted. Brock Parks and the blue Yamaha, buried at the Basson Circuit, set up the Park-Algar team originally.
It's a great circuit, an absolutely fantastic circuit, but the Park-Algar bike, they spent so much time here that you can see that that Yamaha is set up really well.
Yes.
Also, he's taking the... Luciano's taking fantastic lines. He's missing a lot of the bumps, and you can see that he's just eking away from the GMT bike.
So the battle going on ahead of him, that's David Checker, who's got back ahead of Anthony Delhal. Delhal pulled a spiteful move on him when he was shown a few inches of daylight here, actually, when they dropped downhill 2 laps ago while we were on the commercial break. That number 94 bike just drifted wide and was stabbed by Delhal, a real short circuit move. But David quickly responded on bike number 94. Of course, they won the World Championship in 2014 and were deposed by the number one Suzuki in 2015.
So Suzuki playing the long game by the look of it.
Was that there?
Well, they always do, don't they? I mean, you want to see them in the pit stops and the way they're organised. The Cert Suzuki is still, for my money, the reference machine out there. The SRC Kawasaki, though, has shocked me with how consistent all the riders are, all very, very fast, and their organisation in the pits. They've went their own way with Kawasaki, basically, and didn't keep an eye too much on Cert Suzuki. They knew what they wanted to do. They went out there and did it. They weren't worried about anybody else going behind them. That's Christophe Guillaume, I think, up there, having a look at the timing screen in the box.
Yeah, and the GMT Yamaha's caught the Team Moto events bike of Greg Black. He's right up behind him. Now, it's a little bit embarrassing, actually, that the Suzuki, the private Suzuki's in front of the Cert Suzuki, the factory bike. So, but Greg Black doing a fantastic job there, running in second place.
Riding bike number 50, Greg Black has reappeared in the European Superstock 1000 Championship this season after we haven't seen him on the world and European stage in short circuits and since 2009, but he's currently lying 11th in the European Superstock Championship. Had an 8th place last time out at Donington Park a couple of weeks ago, which, of course, you could nail on as his local circuit. He's a Derbyshire boy and originally was brought up as a kid just a few miles away from there. So SRC Kawasaki, and 9 laps complete. Second place battle is there in front of you. Number 50, Greg Black. Number 94, David Checker. And then behind them, we've got the Suzuki of Anthony Delhal, the Yamaha of Matt Luciana, and the number 14 Yamaha that I thought the number 14 Yamaha was being ridden by Marco Yeoman. Has Igor Yeoman retired from racing now?
Yes, I think so. He's at a lot of these circuits and everything, and a lot of the endurance circuits, and just giving a hand and stuff. And he's and just see there, David Checker pulling out from Greg Black. And you see the Yamaha's a little bit quicker than that Suzuki, the Team Moto Suzuki. So he's up to second place. And, you know, I think he's going to start catching the SRC Kawasaki. He's lapping a little bit quicker. The last lap went round in a 147.6 compared to a 148.2 of Greg LeBlanc out in the lead.
So, Greg, there is the April Motors bike that's been just snicked back then to third place, and we'll shortly have the official Suzuki Endurance Racing Team motorcycle nagging at his tyres. Christophe Guyot there on the right-hand side of picture for a moment. He actually had Matt Luciana's dad, Andre Luciana, as a member of his original GMT racing team, which ran Kawasaki's. I didn't realise that back in 97.
When he used to ride, actually, as well. Yes, I used to race against them, when I was racing. All them years ago, Jack, when I was racing World Endurance.
Well, you pass it all forward. These guys, now the teams are managed by the former riders, and they know exactly what they're doing. Christophe.
High drama here in the hills of Portimão, just inland of the beautiful coastline of the Algarve in southern Portugal, because David Checker briefly was put back to second place by the CERT Suzuki of Anthony Del Halle, but he's immediately responded and stuck the GMT Yamaha back at the front. Greg Black has fought his way back into third place, having been demoted to fourth. He got properly duffed up, but he has got back past the SRC Kawasaki, which now has Matt Luciana on the Parkalgar Yamaha for company. So these are the top five. Notice that PJ Jacobsen has set the fastest lap of the race and moved through into seventh place, riding bike number five, his Honda, ahead of the Yamaha of Brock Parks, both of them having been virtually left at the start. And the Honda of Freddie Faure, the brand new dad for a second time, back in 10th place, bike number 111. Team Bollinger down in 14th place, not having the brightest of starts, but the main protagonists are running strongly at the front, and the two blue motorcycles, the Yamaha of David Checker, 17 laps complete. Whoa, and look at the speed of the slipstream that grants the CERT Suzuki as it whisks its way past.
There's a slight Yamaha head. Well, it's probably the easiest bike to ride around this tight twist, the undulating circuit of Portimão, and I think that's going to make a difference towards the end of this race. It really is on the rider's physical sort of values.
If you look at David Checker, every now and again he nods his head. And sometimes you think, oh, is he just getting a bit ticked off with the rider in front of him? No, it's a habit that he seems to have picked up. I've tried to get it out of him where it comes from, and he hasn't told me. But every now and again, especially going into a corner, he'll nod his head.
Yeah.
It's like he's changing his line of sight. Behind them, we were talking about Freddie Faure and Brock Park. In between them is the Team 3 RTM Avenue machine. And you were asking me earlier on, you know, who have I got my eye on? This guy, Lucas Trautmann, he's a very, very young guy. Austrian and a very, very quick guy. I want to keep my eye on him through the race as well. Now, he's in the middle of Parks and Faure battle at the moment.
You see, I'm so impressed with Greg Black running in third position. He's holding his own against these factory bikes out here, and really, really doing well on the Suzuki. So my shout goes to Greg Black so far anyway.
Fastest lap of the race, fastest lap of the last lap, a 47.5, was Anthony Del Halle back at the front there, having slipstreams his way, proving that the GSX-R 1000, with the help of the slipstream, can certainly outstrip the Yamaha down the 1,000-metre straight here.
And the SRC Kawasaki is Greg LeBlanc on board. He's definitely struggling, 148.7. He's over a second slower than these guys at front.
And down in fifth place as well, and being passed by Luciana on the Parkalgar racing.
So Matt Luciana moves through into fourth place for the Parkalgar Racing Team on their debut in the Endurance World Championship, with these two guys battling at the front. And once again, David Checker gives his head a little flick as he backs his way in into the left-hander, then short, sharp uphill, and then over the blind crest, and then a huge downhill plunge into the left-hander at turn five. Checker, he's trying to force a way through, whether the CERT Suzuki likes it or not. Beautiful bike control from Checker. Has he got the drive up the hill? Oh, boys!
Wow.
Go elbow to elbow, don't you? Over the crest, into the right-hander, then into the 50-mile-an-hour right-hander, that then leads up to a blind crest, and the fabulous Craig Jones, 120 mile an hour left-hander, down the hill and into this fabulous turn that's named after the late great Craig Jones, who was a huge popular favourite here, rode for the Parkelgar Honda team in World Supersport.
There's a statue out the front, one of the only marble and stainless steel statues of a bike and rider. There's a huge monument to him down there.
That is indeed Jonesy, yes. Yeah. He's a very popular figure in these parts. So JMT Yamaha 94, Christophe Guyot's team leads the way again, but for how long? Checker knows that the Suzuki, if he gets the drive out of here, mind you, Checker got good drive. Could he possibly break the toll before he gets onto the finishing straight? This will be the crucial point as they go through the massive exiting at close to 100 miles an hour onto the home straight. This is where the Suzuki... No, I think it's too far back.
No, he's catching.
Is it?
He's
no, it's coming.
Because of that headwind, the further back you are, the more of a slipstream you'll actually get, because the bike in front's punching its way through the air and it's trying to, you know, push that air, frontal area in front. Remember, it's 180 miles an hour straight here. So when you come in up from behind, if there's a headwind as well, it's a double whammy for you. You can actually get a great... You can make a difference of 5 or 6, 7 miles an hour. And we've seen that on the Cert Suzuki. It really has made...
And has closed the gap back up. So back with live action as we approach the 40-minute mark.
Look at the slipstream effect. There, Del Hale gets a fantastic draft on the David Checker on the GMT bike. The Checker fights back on the brakes going into turn one. Almost loses the front end there.
Oh,
Del Hale just kind of almost closes his eyes. Wow, that was close. And again, David Checker sliding around going into turn three.
Checker's at the age of 36. He hasn't cooled off any, has he?
Not at all. We love it. It's great. It's fantastic. And, you know, you can see the Yamaha is slightly down on speed. You just see there, going to turn six, this bump here. See that bump? Just as they turn it, it's the worst place you can possibly get a bump as you start really pushing that front end into that left-hander, turn six.
That's where Norihaga crashed and lost the World Superbike Championship in the first race, last round, yep. 2009.
I remember that, yep.
It's an evil spot on the track coming down there. So these front three then have broken away a bit. The Parkelgar Yamaha running 5 seconds adrift of the leader is 0.6 seconds ahead of the number 11 Kawasaki, which in turn is only 0.5 seconds clear. Portimao in the second round of the FIM Endurance World Championship. These are the front three riders, absolutely neck and neck as they storm the finishing line. The world champion Cert Suzuki team, Anthony Del Halle, the Frenchman, number one, moves briefly past David Checker, and once again the Spaniard from Barcelona outbreaks him on the descent into turn one.
We got on the gas a little bit early there going into turn two. Checker backs into turn three and really having to push around the turns. You can see that Yamaha is definitely down on speed compared to the Suzuki. Greg Black's is about a similar sort of pace, but remember, Greg Black's on a privateer bike. That Cert Suzuki is a full factory machine. Del Howie is on number one bike. It's a full factory bike. And you can see that down the start finish straight.
Anthony Del Howie, the 34-year-old from Chartres, as a former Qatari Superbike champion back in 2010, done some of his racing in the Middle East, as well as, of course, having enjoyed winning the World Endurance Championship on three occasions now. No, make that four, because they won it again last year, of course. So four times world champ, chasing down David Checker, who's a mere double world endurance champion for GMT 94.
How long is this going to go on for?
I don't know. We were just gesticulating in the background, going, who's going to go past who next?
Oh, Black.
Fantastic.
Black does them both in one stab.
What a move. That was fantastic. We've said that Greg Black seems to have far more corner speed than the other two, but doesn't quite have the power down the straight. Although it's about similar.
It's waving his hand in four old David.
Checker's getting upset.
What have you done there?
He's getting very upset, isn't he? All that work, he said, I've led this race for such a long time, and now I'll get duffed up and pushed out of the way. He's got to regroup now. The best thing he can do is get in the slipstream and try and tuck his way down that straight. see the Cert Suzuki so much quicker than the privateer Suzuki.
Look at the speed of that.
Yeah, but that's slipstream, isn't it? It's got to be slipstream.
It is, but the Suzuki's probably, Cert Suzuki's probably 5 or 6 horsepower more than Greg Black's minimum compared. That's the difference between riding a full factory bike and riding a privateer bike. Greg Black will be on a kitted bike, which is not going to be quite as strong as the factory boys. And remember, these engines are in endurance spec. They've got to last 12 hours, so they'll be running things like extra rings on the pistons. They'll be running a much less less tolerances on the valve to piston clearances, because things like that really make a difference. Because a bike set up for short circuit racing is is what it says for short circuit, to last 45-50 minutes at full gas. We see there on the right hand side Christophe Guillot coming out. He's the team manager of GMT Yamaha.
Better fuel economy.
Not allowed to have any more fuel than anyone else out there.
GMT 94 come in.
Just come in, but they're running that bike. They're the experts of being able to run that Cert Suzuki so efficiently that they normally can put in more laps in a stint. So. Interesting to see that's the strategy they're playing. But normally when you run a bike and it can run extra laps, it means it's slower. But we've seen that Cert Suzuki, on average, is probably one of the fastest bikes out there. Not as fast as the SRC Kawasaki, but it is still quick. And that could really, really make a big difference in this race towards the end of the race, where they're not having to stop so much. We've seen Cert Suzuki do it so many times, haven't we?
The so well caliper organized. Just gone out now.
Now, this is an intriguing fella to come into this, because this is Nicolò Canepa, again, he won the European Superstock 1000 Championship back in 2007. And he's had a lifetime spent principally with Ducati, MotoGP, test rider, all that kind of stuff, Ducati junior team. And to have him get sprung onto a Yamaha for 2016 is...
In the cert team, in the factory team. He's got to be one of the best riders out on the circuit at the moment.
Who would you drop from the cert team?
He's got a quality. Yeah, okay, all right.
He's got a pretty good quality.
I'd just like to see Greg have a bit of a chance, really, out there, you know.
I'll tell you why, because Dominic can't be bothered speaking English.
He speaks fantastic French.
I've just remembered, of course, Greg Black speaks brilliant French. He's lived in France since he was a kid.
You wouldn't know it to think he was English to the limit, which means that when he comes in, and he has to come in, he'll probably have to change his tyres as well.
He will do, yeah. But 147.8, he's still quick out there on the tyres. Here's David Checker, just as we speak now, he's pushing round last lap, 147.8, so he's absolutely flying again. I'm sure they'll put him out. Do you think they'll put him out on the bike? I'm so excited. This is fantastic.
I don't think they'll change a rider now. I mean, he's in full attack mode, and he's not going to come off of that. But will those tyres, will Christophe think, well, we've got 33 minutes, can I keep him out on those tyres?
We don't know, but right now, David Checker is headed out in the lead, all to play for after the break, folks. Don't go away. Welcome back as Etienne Masson scorches across the line. 38 seconds adrift of the GMT 94 Yamaha, which has retaken the lead here. And we have Luca Mahias waiting, his fellow Frenchman, waiting in the Yamaha garage to take over from Barcelona's very own David Checker in the race to the finish. And what a dramatic race it is going to be. David Checker from Sant Fruitós de Bages, just outside Barcelona, in fact, the 2004 and 2014 World Endurance Champions GMT 94. These, the reigning and, at least 9 times World Endurance Champions, the Suzuki Endurance Racing Team. Here is Checker, still putting in fast lap times, despite the wearing tyres towards the end of his stint. And as darkness begins
down the pit lane again.
So here comes.
He's got to come in now.
It's very timely because Checker's just getting hooked up behind a couple of rivals. So perfect timing. He pulls into the pit lane now. This is crucial, folks. GMT 94. Christophe Guillot in his 20th season as a team owner, former rider, of course, and twice world championship winner, brings David Checker in. Luca Mahias, the 27-year-old relative rookie in the Endurance World Championship Series, waits patiently.
They're only going to change the rear.
They're not doing the front. They're only going to change the rear.
You know why that is? That's because he can get out there and push really hard at the beginning. The front tyre won't. He won't have to bed the front tyre into it quite so long. So he's going to have to be really careful with that rear tyre. Really good call that is with from Christoph Guillaume there.
Nico Canepa praying on the left-hand side of the picture there as the bandy-legged Guillaume goes out. And this is the drama then.
Where's the Here he comes.
Where's the Serge Suzuki? Is this him? Yes! Anthony, beg your pardon, Etienne Masson goes past.
Keep it going.
Almost together on the track now. There's about 5 or 6 seconds between them.
He's got to be really careful here now because he's going to get plenty of feel from that front tyre, David Checker.
I was going to say, you notice that they dressed up Luca Mahias, but they've sent Checker straight back out on that front tyre he's used to carry on the pursuit.
And Checker will be able to see Etienne Masson out in the lead now. He'll be able to see him ahead. The only problem he's got the FCC Honda in front of him, and they're going to be difficult to pass. They are going to be difficult to pass because they are quick. And that's PJ Jackerson on board doing 48.9. So he can't afford, David Checker can't afford to spend too much time behind PJ here.
Oh, look at this fabulous setting here in the Algarve. And as they come over the top of the brow, this is David Checker. And ahead of him, he's got the FCC TSR Honda of Patrick Jacobson, the pint-sized New Yorker, who they incidentally are running in 12th place in the race at the moment after their earlier clutch problems. And ahead of them, ahead of that, is the number one Cert Suzuki. This is absolute drama. Let's have a quick interview. William Cost.
GMT 94 box with William Cost, racing manager of the team. William, David just came back to the pits for the last pit stop. Why did you choose to keep David on the bike?
Yes, because the night is coming and he already knows the condition and probably is already on the rhythm and he can... So I just check only 3 seconds behind the Suzuki. I think we can win a few seconds if we start again. And we choose the best solution. It's a great race, and I would like to congratulate all the team because they did a very, very, very good job.
So less than 4 seconds before the last half hour of the race. It's going to be a sprint race till the end.
Yes, it's just a racing race. It's fantastic. Everything is possible now.
En français, William.
Non, on a décidé de faire repartir David parce qu'en fait...
Look at David Checker. Absolutely. He's desperate to get back out there again, isn't he?
They were never going to be, besides knocking him on the head and then rendering him stone cold, they weren't going to stop and get him back on that bike.
He was so eager, just so eager. 3.7 seconds the gap at the moment.
Last lap round for Suzuki Cert Team, 147.9. So we'll see what David Checker does on this flying lap. But
he's got a problem now. That rear tyre's been really bedded in.
Yeah.
He's really pushing.
It has, but he's got PJ Jacobson just in front of him. And PJ's going to be difficult to pass because he's late on the brakes and he's quick for the turn. So he's got to get past him as quickly as possible just to get hook on the back of Etienne Masson we're seeing there on Cert Suzuki.
So Etienne Masson, there he is. And there is number 5, Patrick Jacobson. There is number 94, the GMT 94 Yamaha. And this is just a battle royale. We've got just under 23 and a half minutes to go here before the checkered flag will appear at the end of what is a pretty stunning race here. The first time endurance racing has come to Portimão in the Algarve. And let's see, hope it comes back again because this is some kind of introduction. And as the bikes... There is the race leader, and the second of those bikes is the second placeman. That is how close it is, folks. 380 laps complete, 2.641 seconds.
Taking a second out of him
them.
On that lap.
And
fastest lap of his.
46.69 seconds for the GMT Yamaha. And look, folks, you're not going to believe this, but I've been told we're going to take a quick break. I can't believe it myself. We'll be back as soon as we possibly can. Hold your breath. In the space of about 400 metres metres. David Checker has scalded his way past both Patrick Jacobson and Bastian Mackels, and he's now closing the gap on the race leader. Other people are sitting up, realising what's happened, getting out of the way, getting a grandstand view of what's going on here. David Checker is closing the gap tantalisingly on Etienne Masson. Here you see it as they come through the massive final turn and onto the 1,000-metre finishing straight. We've got 11 hours and 40 minutes gone, 20 minutes to go. There are the two race leaders, and there's one back marker between them. Checker howls down the main straight on the GMT 94 Yamaha Etienne Masson plunges downhill into turn one.
And the masters are waving the blue flags now just to show the riders that they're a little bit slower to get out of the way. And GMT
Bolliger does.
Perfect.
Team Bolliger gets straight out of the way. So David Checker a little bit offline there, but he pulls the Yamaha back. And now it's beginning to turn into a slugfest between Suzuki versus Yamaha.
Well, look at the times they're putting in. Etienne Masson, 47.356. Got to have to give you all three numbers there. 47.207. And David Checker had to pass a lot of people on that one. Etienne knows what he needs to do, needs to keep ahead, and he's trying everything he needs to do. But I tell you this, I've never seen David Checker in such a full-on race-focused mood as this.
I've never seen both of them. Etienne Masson, Suzuki, this being so close. It's unbelievable. 2.1 seconds between the two of them after 11 hours and 40 minutes.
Yeah, nearly 18 minutes to go, and this... The fight's going to go all the way to the wire, even in these 20 minutes. This is going to be a short circuit race.
The gloves are off, boys.
And remember, Checker is a man who's raced 250 GPs, he's raced World Superbikes, he's raced World Super Sport, all of them intertwined with a stellar career in the World Endurance Championship. He knows how to scrap on a short circuit, and this, ladies and gentlemen, is scrapping on a short circuit.
And we know that David Checker doesn't mind getting his elbows out, he doesn't mind a bit of argy-bargy as well, so if it comes to that right at the end, he's going to be there and thereabouts, he's going to be out there with his elbows straight out. Look at Etienne Masson going a little bit wide there, up onto the curbs. He realises what's at stake.
While we were on a break, we saw him go past PJ. You know how difficult it is to get past PJ. And he just did it. Not a problem. Stopped on the back brake, just backed it in behind. And it was a safe pass as well, and even at these speeds.
Look at the team on the right-hand side. They're just there holding their arms.
Oh, look at that man.
Dominic Million, seen it all before. He's staying calm, cool, but his eyes just... light up a little bit there. Wow, the pressure's on. I think he knows the writing's on the wall. David Checker is quicker.
Now, Dominic's eyes only light up when a pretty woman appears in front of him. That's usually what fires his imagination. 1.859 seconds, another two, just over two tenths clawed out of that advantage. Etienne Masson, you have to say, is riding an immaculate front runner's race here. He's not making any mistakes. He's putting in very consistent lap times. And of course, all the time, these guys are dealing with gathering dust. That just to throw another complication in. That's something you certainly don't get very often when you're riding in Grand Prix and World Superbikes.
David Checker, once again, 0.3 of a second faster on that lap.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is 11 hours, 43 minutes and 20 seconds of racing, and there are the two leaders warring not only for maximum points here, but also, of course, critically for crucial advantages at the halfway stage of the World Endurance Championship.
And it's so disconcerting for a rider to be seeing his pit lane. Etienne Masson in his pit lane, his pit bull would be saying to him, minus 0.2, minus 0.3. The time will be coming down. He knows that David Checker is actually catching him, lap by lap, dragging him in. That's the gap.
Etienne Masson, who's he's competed mainly in World Endurance Championship racing and French promo sport and French super sport racing. But he made his Bulldog debut way back in 2007. He's experienced at this game.
Look at the time.
How much experience does he need here? Look at that. It's down to 0.6 of a second.
But, Jack, there's one thing passing, OK, but there's another thing pulling away. Etienne Masson, I can't see David Checker pulling away because... They've been racing for 12 hours. There's no way he's going to allow that to happen. This is going to be down to a last lap dash, I'm sure it is.
So we're down to... hang on, we've got just 15 minutes, slightly over 15 minutes to go.
The headlights on the back of Etienne Masson. He's going to know that David Checker's there now. He's going to know he's on his back. You can see his headlight. Just look on the inside there. Be showing him that front end. Do you see that?
That must be a horrible feeling. Have you been in this position?
Horrible. It is a real horrible feeling. I've got a feel for Etienne Masson.
But, mate, he's not been overtaken yet. And no. David Checker's got to find a way past him. This is a situation that calls for a cool head. Has Checker got it? Has Masson got it? This is just brilliant. Well, two World Championship teams of the last 2 years locked together.
David's going to stay with him and see if he's got a chance of passing him without having to think about it, he's going to do it. But he'll watch him. He'll find out where his chance will be.
And he's going to drag the headlight to the right, to the left of him, to try and put him off as much as possible. I know it sounds bad, but these are the sort of tactics you've got to use when you're behind. And David Checker squaring the last corner off, trying to get the drive out to the start-finish straight. He does so, but the Yamaha isn't quite as fast as the Cert Suzuki in the straight line.
And that, again, fastest lap of their race, GMT 94, 46.5 to catch him. And now that gap,
now, this
0.3
is,
it says.
This is where together. This is where Checker's strong. Yes. No, he's not going to try it this time. That's where he cut away, right there, inside PJ Jacobson.
They were close then. Where's it going to happen, Etienne thinks?
It's difficult to say anything. I'm just so
I know, we're riveted to it. We're thinking, is he going to do it here? Is he going to do it there? And I think that's what Etienne's thinking at the moment. Oh, a little bit of a bubble. Almost opened the door for him. But David said, no, I've got time to do it. We've got 13 minutes. I'm sure I can get past within 13 minutes.
I don't know about that. Do you know what I'd do? I'd attack now.
He's done it. He just waited for that moment when Etienne Masson's concentration was just affected there by the back marker, and he dived through the gap. And the GMT Yamaha 90. Now he becomes the target man. Checker becomes the target man. Etienne Masson is going to attack him straight back.
This isn't over. I'll tell you that now. Etienne Masson will attack back. He has to. He has to fight back immediately.
The GMT 94 Yamaha is back in the lead at 11 hours, 48 minutes, 47 minutes. Oh, dear. And this is, this is a perfect Wild West setting. They come and they film Wild West movies around the hills here down in Portugal. You could just see the Indians lurching out, charging out of the woodlands here. We've got a couple of Indians of our own here fighting it out.
Watch the Suzuki down the straight. He's going to get the drive onto the start-finish straight. I'm sure he's going to go past David Checker. It's faster, Sir Suzuki. Look at that going down the straight. He's done it.
But then
can he outbreak him at the end in turn one? He does.
David Checker will be late on the brakes when he comes back underneath him. It's something that he's been doing throughout this race.
Oh, and he's done it again. This is a gunfight down here. He needed to do that. It was a very, very risky move to do it, but he's taking those risks.
David Checker just lost the rear end there. He's spinning up. They're doing 146s. They're doing their fastest laps of this race in the dark at the end of the stint. Unbelievable.
David Checker, the 36-year-old from just outside Barcelona, he's grabbed almost half a dozen bike lengths there through his speed of line through the tighter corners. And it's Etienne Masson who is the guy that Dominic Malion chose to do the last stint here. I thought it was going to be Anthony Delhal, but it's Masson who's been given that opportunity. Look at the darkness. That's through the screaming left-hander of the Craig Jones corner. And look at some of those lines Etienne Masson can take. Just that little bit tighter, just saving himself a few precious inches.
And he's struggling now. He's trying not to lose the toe. You know, this is such an important part of the race for Etienne Masson. If he lets Checker go now, it's all over. But he's dragged a little bit, a couple of tenths back. So it's still on, the fight's still on.
Again, look at the line he can hold all the way around the initial part there at the turn 13 and then 14 and then the exit and the huge barreling right-hander again. He saves himself time by trying to tuck in on the Yamaha through the last turn 15.
Checker knows it's so important to get the drive onto the start-finish straight because Etienne Masson, Cert Suzuki, he is quicker down the straight. You can see that.
He's going to do it again.
And this time, if he cuts inside, Checker's not going to be in such a good position to outbreak him at the bottom. Exactly.
Oh, I squared him.
Oh, He squared him inside because the bugs are, Masson just ran himself slightly deep on the brakes.
But you know what, Jack? At the end, as long as Checkers first going into that last corner, turn 15, at the end of the race, he will get across the start-finish line first, because the Cert Suzuki is only quicker at the end of the straight. It's got more top speed than the Yamaha. The Yamaha coming off the turn is pretty good.
Can this go on for another 10 minutes? Etienne, every time he gets past, boom! David Checkers passed again. Boom! He's been passed again. He's quicker on the draw in this gunfight, and it's got to be wearing down on Etienne, thinking, well, where can I do it and make it
well
stick?
The only place Etienne Masson can pass is down the start finish straight. We've seen that the Yamaha is much more nimble than the Suzuki going through the turns, and also David Checker is quicker, so it's all going to be down to that last corner.
Oh, I know, we're taking a breath as the sun sets here on this continuing battle. And it's pointless having a look at the timing screens now, just to tell you where everybody else is. Honda, it's still in third place. Yamaha in fourth place. Team Aprilia Motors in fifth. Tadi Team Beaujolais, the first of the Superstock machines, in sixth place. Then Volker NRT 48 in seventh. In eighth, it's the number 72 Junior LMS. In ninth, Team 3Art Diam Avenue. And in tenth, it's the Lukoil BM Motorrad machine.
Let's listen to these bikes.
Masson gets way out across the curve in his desperate efforts to get a toll from the Yamaha, and I think he might be just a little bit too far back this time. Checker is safe as they drop into turn one. 11 hours, 51 minutes and 20 seconds have already passed. We're into the absolute closing stages of the maiden 12 hours of Portimao, and I think we'll judging by this, we'll be back for more, because yes, this is one of the most enthralling climaxes to a world endurance race we've witnessed.
It is awesome. It's just awesome. It's fantastic. And there's about four laps, maybe five laps left in this race. And looks like Checkers just broken the back of Etienne Masson. He's managed to pull out about four or five tenths.
47.3, and you just need to break them just by about a turn.
Yeah, but we've got traffic coming up.
The traffic is going to be a vital part to play here. Can the traffic see any blue flags? I doubt it in this degree of dark. But oh, look at this. How do you like it, folks? As darkness falls, you have the drama of a high-speed chase, and David Checker has got to come up on these guys at the right moment, not to be hindered by them. And he's got a track full of them at the moment, because they're having a little squabbling session of their own. He dives underneath the first one.
He dives underneath the second one.
He makes it through. And Etienne Masson looks like he's been bulked a little bit by these slower guys. No, he just got through them.
Just had to alter his line a little bit, but these two guys are absolutely flying. And I think a lot of the guys have seen the blue flags around. And they've been going around and around and around and doing this. And for hours now, GMT 94 has been on the hunt, has been trying to chase down Suzuki. They've had to eke out half a second, quarter of a second, tenth of a second, here and there, and they've done it, and they're right out in front, but still, Etienne Masson is not going to give up.
And that was a crucial outbreaking manoeuvre there by Checker, just slotting that back marker in between himself. And look at that, Etienne Masson has got bulk just where he desperately didn't need to
be. Was that the Honda? Yeah, it was. 1-1-1 Honda. So he's running in third place.
That gives Checker a tiny bit of breathing space here, but only a tiny bit of breathing space. Scarcely enough to catch his breath, as we got just under 7 minutes to go here at the end of this 12-hour race.
We're having a look at this. First sector, David Checker did his fastest sector of all of the entire race. Etienne Masson, the third sector, did his fastest sector of the entire race. They are on it everywhere.
These boys are hanging it out 110%.
David Checker, whose first ever world endurance win was the Oscher Schlaben 24 hours back in 2003. He's been a regular on the podium in world endurance events ever since. But this just could be, if he could cling on, the greatest victory of his racing life. He and Etienne Masson, either of them, they could produce their greatest victory right here, right now. And Masson has clawed back a few feet on the GMT Yamaha.
He's regrouping.
And for heaven's sake, how long has David Checker been out on that motorcycle, guys? It must be the thick end of an hour and a half.
Easy.
Wow. But remember, he's on that front tyre is starting to get a little bit worn now.
Nico Canepa there, shaking a hand anxiously in the GMT 94 garage. Oh, again, look at how wide the Suzuki goes in an attempt to hang on to the pace of the Yamaha.
This is crazy. This is absolutely crazy. Just a tad over 5 minutes left. They'll be going at like this. They've been going like this for the past 2 hours. They're going to do it again for another 5 minutes.
390 laps complete by the race leaders. And again, in the bit of the track where we expect Checker to be quickest, Etienne Masson has closed the gap on him through turns 2, 3 and 4.
Look how dark it's getting, chaps, as well. On parts of this circuit, it's getting very, very dark now as the sun goes down. And the front end there moved on Checker's bike. Just folded under a little bit, spins it up coming out of turn 6. But you'll just see this part of the circuit now starts getting really, really dark. Really difficult to find your turning points, and there's some light in here. But I know the Craig Jones turn, the far sweeping left downhill section, just where we're coming through now. Look how dark it is here.
Luca Mahias is probably thinking, I'm glad I'm not out there doing this.
I don't know. I think if you're out there, you wouldn't want to come back in, would you?
No, well, just as Checker didn't. And Checker still is trying to check out, but he's still got that blazing headlight of the Cert Suzuki behind him. The two most successful teams in recent endurance racing history, and locked together with, 11
Four
hours,
minutes.
56 minutes gone out of 12 hours, folks.
4 minutes left to go. He's just got to keep it up. We've got
two and a bit more laps. Once they go across the start-finish line, they've got 2 laps left.
And that's what it's down to. 2 laps to go, folks, as we cross the finishing line now. They'll get a 2 lap to go board. They've just got to keep it all together, the two of them. Both of these teams deserve victory here, but whatever, to actually participate in a race as excruciatingly exciting as this is, I would say a reward in itself, but I'm sure that the guys who finished second won't agree with me. Checker on the limit.
Etienne Masson would have seen that.
He's right on the back of Checker now. I can't call this. I'd say that Checker's got the extra speed, but Etienne Masson may have something up his sleeve.
And we've got more traffic just ahead of these guys. Oh, that bump ball was fragmented.
It's his front tyre. I think he's thinking about that at the moment, David.
Yeah, starting to get. He's done a session and a half on that front tyre. Remember that the GMT team didn't change their. Didn't change the front tyre. Last lap round, 146.7. 146.6 for the Cert Suzuki team.
And their fastest lap of the race.
And they're catching all the time. So we're going to be looking at about a lap and a half of this race. 11 hours, 57 minutes.
How do you set your fastest lap of the race at this point?
When there's so much at stake, they just have to do it, I guess.
It's pure adrenaline. How do you race on pure adrenaline and keep a clear head? This is an illustration of how you do it. Oh, it's tightening back up again. Etienne Masson is coming back onto the rear wheel of David Checker.
I know what David's thinking. David's thinking, a back marker. I need one. Can I get one?
Yeah.
I want a back marker, please, now.
Yeah, but that can run against him as well, you know.
Yep,
look at David Checker squaring it off now. Now, Etienne Masson is close enough to get the slipstream. He could pass him at the end of the straight. Remember, this could be the last lap. 2 minutes left.
Masson much tidier through the final turn there. 58 minutes and 15 seconds.
We're going to just go into a second lap, so we've got 2 more laps left. There was 2 minutes to run across the line.
It's too much. Hold me up, boys.
David Checker has just got to trust in that front tyre. Just see what he's got left in it. Just see if he can use it to keep Etienne Masson behind. He's been able to catch him, and I would say quite handily, but Etienne, again, has found something from where I do not know.
He probably doesn't know himself. Look at the tension in the garages. Oh, this is just a superb race. People are riding off the track to get out of the way.
Does he give me a headache?
You run out of...
Superlatives.
Perfectly. I mean, we know there's just a minute to go. Less than a minute to go. The next time they cross the start and finish line, after that minute, that's it. The race is over. It's only 6 points in it, but it doesn't matter. It's for the win.
No, this is going to be it.
This might be the last lap.
This will be it.
This could be the final 59, lap.
29. Yeah, it will be, definitely. This is it. We've got half a lap left of this.
And they are right on each other's tail.
They're tenths apart.
David Checker, GMT 94 Yamaha, twice a world champion. Behind him, Etienne Masson, a part of the reigning world champion Sir Suzuki team, into the huge final turn. Here comes the Suzuki up the inside. David Checker brings it across to try and cut his line up. Checker has it. Is he going to get the checkered flag, or will it be another lap to go as they come across the line? Does the checkered flag go? Yes, it does, and he's got it. David Checker wins it. 393 laps, 800th of a second as they cross the line after 12 hours of pure full-blooded competition here in Portugal. What a devastating conclusion to the first ever 12 hours of 40 mile, an absolute exultation in the GMT Yamaha 94 squad in the garage. Well, what an epic that was.
That was fantastic. What a race. That's got to be one of the best races I've ever seen, an endurance race anyway, that's for sure.
So the Endurance World Championship lights up Portugal in more ways than one. And David Checker putting in a huge final stint on a well-used front tyre and on pure adrenaline, and going back to his 250 Grand Prix and World Supersport route, scratching out a victory by 800ths of a second over Etienne Masson. What a race. A massive burnout for David Checker in his Carlos Checker replica helmet. He's done his big brother proud here in Portugal with a brilliant victory in simply the most exciting world endurance race we've probably ever seen. And the GMT 94 boys, their elation contrasted with the despair and disappointment of the grace in defeat of Dominic Melian's Sirt Suzuki team. What an epic race that was. And you can see David Checker there. Well, he'll now, of course, be utterly elated, but he's put so much into that. He's been out for an hour and a half. And those two guys, of course, are debut winners in the Endurance World Championship. His teammates, Luca Mahias, they're giving him a hug, and the Italian Nicolò Canepa. A huge debut victory for them. And they're going to think that Endurance World Championship racing is always like this.
GMT 94, David Checker. David, what a last stint you did. You came back on the number one third bike. You overtook Masson. And you kept the lead till the end. What a great race from you today.
But anyway, for me, the only target was to win. I pushed 110%. Honestly, I pushed really, really hard, more sometimes at the limit. And for me, it's the best victory I did in my life. Incredible.
Yeah.
Yes. En Espanol, David.
You've got to just agree with him. The best victory in his racing life.
I've never seen him race like that. That was brilliant.
Well, that was definitely his kind of his 250 GP World Supersport genes coming through.
What he did say, 110%. That was absolutely true.
Yes. And it was 110%. Anything less wouldn't have won it for him.
No. He had to take risks there.
Thank you, David.
Look at the winning margin, 0.081. That's 800ths of a second separating Etienne Masson and David Checker as they howled across the line. The Honda finishes third. Yamaha recovers to fourth. Seventh place for Bastian Mackels. They, of course, have not the winners. It was the sixth place Tati team Beaujolais Racing bike that won the Super Stock category. And down in 12th place, incidentally, we saw the FCC TSR Honda with Patrick Jacobson taking their last stint. Miguel Oliveira sadly crashed out for the second time. Miguel Pryor and Matt Luciana particularly performing really strongly on the Parkelgar Racing Team R1. Let's hope we see them back in action again. Look at this beautiful scene here. Fabulous facility at Portimão and a fabulous race. How could they expect anything greater than that when we arrived here with Endurance World Championship Racing for the first time, Terry?
Jack, that has to be the closest world endurance race ever. In history. It has to be.
On any number of wheels. 2-4-6. David Checker then chatting there to Niko Kanepa. Absolute joy.
Our top five, they're all endurance world championship machines, all the way down to the Team April Motos events. And here's the points.
They lead 66 points to 60 from SRC Kawasaki from their Le Mans win. Suzuki Endurance Racing Team go third on 59. FCC TSR Honda still in on 53. GMT 94 Yamaha rocket up to 45 points. All those teams still very, very much in the mix. I'd like you to have left that up a little bit longer so I could see the virtual championship standings rather more than that. But what we do know is there's one point in it at the top of the championship tree. We've got the Suzuka 8 hours coming up next, and I think that takes place on July the 31st, ladies and gentlemen, and we'll be bringing you that full-blooded and all the way through here on Eurosport. But what an if you can do anything like that, produce anything like that for us. The virtual championship standings in the manufacturers, 71 points for Suzuki, 64 for Yamaha, 60 for Honda, 53 for Kawasaki, and 29 points for BMW.
It has been desperately adding up the points, and I just didn't get to them in time. The April to figure out where they were after 8 hours, so I couldn't add the points in. And you've got so much to do, but I did know that they were going to be well up there, but I didn't actually realise they'd be leading the championship after this race.
Trying to have a look at the front.
And GMT 94 Yamaha, the victors, as they come up here. David Checker, his teammates bowing before him because they are experiencing victory for the first time in the Endurance World Championship in what is close to their first race. Luca Mahias and Niko Kanepa.
Dominic Mayon gave him a nice little pat on the head there. Did you see that? Well done.
And that man, Christophe Guyot, the genius of not changing that front tyre. That was the critical factor. That was what won it for them, I think, Terence.
That's what gave him the edge, I think. And David Checker got out into that stint so quickly, got up to speed so quickly. And you're probably right, Jack. I think it actually got him onto the back of the Suzuki. And that really made the difference. So got to remember, Christophe Guyot is an ex-rider. And he understands these things from a rider's point of view. It's so important.
So an absolutely fabulous event here. Hard to describe, really, the high drama of that grand finale. Armando Marquez of the Portuguese Motorcycling Federation presents trophies to the gallant runner-ups. You have to say, Dominic Melian and the boys, hats off to you guys. What a race you made of that. Disappointment there may be at the moment, but those 59 points and a close second, a third in the championship have flung them right back into contention for that 10th world title.
And it makes it so much more interesting for us, the fans, the commentators, everybody, because it closes up the championship at the top. The top
nice.
Five guys are close.
Decent, big trophies for a team which scored absolutely no points at Le Mans, which broke down, which was out. Three crashes from Louis Rossi just ruled them out of the race, and they've come back in the strongest and most definitive way possible by winning.
Yeah.
In the most extraordinary race I've seen in World Endurance for years and years.
Now they're back in the hunt. GMT are back in the hunt.
This is where they said their season starts. Starts with a bang, it does. Brilliant racing from all of them. You know, it is a team event. It's not just the riders which are going to do it, and they did it, but the team that put that bike together.
Christophe Guyot, who turns 54 now. next month. Fabulous performance by his lead rider, David Checker, a man who's been with him loyally since 2004 and that first World Championship success. All of these guys can be proud of their efforts and enjoy the champagne here at an extraordinary conclusion to the 12 hours of Portimao, and with a lot more endurance World Championship action to come, and I think a lot more alcohol to be consumed during the course of this evening, because all these guys have earned it big time.
Well, they got one day off, one evening off to party, and tomorrow they'll be starting work on the next event to come up, probably the greatest motorcycle race in the world. Everywhere else, in World Superbikes, in MotoGP, anything you can imagine, there is a budget. But we're going to a place where there is no budget, where the vaults are open, where the checkbooks are flourish, where the wallets are opened and said, take all you need. We are going to Suzuka next.
And these guys, David Checker, Luca Mahias, and as we look at... this is the Super Sport, the Super Stock standings. Team 3R Yam Avenue on 34 points, level with Volker NRT, 48 by Schubert. And they are 8 points ahead of the AM Motor Racing Competition. The junior ML team LMS Suzuki on 21 points. But these teams, of course, will be headed to Suzuka to take on the might of the native Japanese. And not forgetting, of course, the FCC TSR Honda team that have graced us with their presence this epic weekend.